Hey, what, do you remember what this morning we talked about doing? Who was it?
Joshua.
And I told you I want to do a two-part series on Joshua. We may expand it actually later, but I want you to turn, does everybody have notes right now? Okay, make sure you have notes. We're going to be following up them, but Joshua 1, 5 through 9. Now, they're going to put the scripture on here. Can you see the scripture behind me? Am I right in the way? Can you see it?
Good.
Good, I'm right in front of it. That's good, right? Joshua chapter 1, verse 5 through 9. No man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, this is God speaking to Joshua, as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not leave you, nor will I forsake you. Be strong and of good courage, for to this people you shall divide as an inheritance of land which I swore to their fathers to give them. Only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Have I not commanded you, be strong and of good courage? Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Lord, I praise you for tonight. I thank you, Lord, that you're going to anoint my words. You, Holy Spirit, will speak. That it won't be me, Lord, but you. Give me the right words to speak and work in the hearts of your people. Work in their minds, work in their spirits. I praise you for that. Amen. Yeah. This morning we talked about pushing through by using CPR. Does anybody remember what that stood for? Anyone? That's okay if you don't, because I'm going to tell you. First, it was consistent in prayer. Everybody say consistent.
Consistent.
Consistent in prayer. Persistent. Everybody say persistent.
Persistent.
Persistent in obedience to the call. And lastly, righteous as unto the Lord. Everyone say righteous.
Righteous.
We want to be righteous in the eyes of the Lord, just as Joshua was. He was not righteous for his own sake. He wasn't going around, look at me, look at me. Look what God has done through me. No, it was about being righteous as to the Lord, because he gave God the glory. Tonight's sermon is entitled, Running the Race. Joshua spent 20 years in Egypt in slavery. Then he wandered around in the wilderness for 40 years. And then he fought in the promised land for 50 years. God used the first 60 years of Joshua's life as a slave for the Egyptians and an assistant to Moses to prepare him to lead God's people into the promised land. If there was ever anybody in the Bible that knows what it means to run the race, it was Joshua. Joshua is not one that just was born and all of a sudden he's running the race. He knows exactly what he's doing. Joshua had to go through a lot of hell. He had to go through a lot of walks. He had to go through a lot of stuff that hit him because he was running the race and God was preparing him for something amazing to do. Joshua excelled in four different areas. And I want you to think about these four areas according to scripture here. Because as God was talking to Joshua, as he was speaking to him, He was speaking to his spirit. He was speaking to him and saying, this is what I want you to do. This is how I want you to be. You see, God doesn't just talk to us and say, hey, you know what? I'm just going to do whatever I want to do. And God says, well, I'm just going to meet you where you are and just follow after you. No, that's not how it works. God says, you do this and you do this and I can direct you in that way. What a fascinating thing on how God works in this. And we can see how he does it with Joshua. Number one, he was strong and very courageous. God says, no man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. That is an amazing charge. Think about that. No man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. You understand where Joshua was right now. He was in the promised land, and 40 years prior, he had gone together with 12 spies, all of them together, to Canaan, to spy out the land. You know what they saw? They saw these huge grapes. Grapes so large it took two men to carry just one bundle of grapes. A bunch. Thank you. A bunch of grapes. Those grapes were like this. They were huge. Took two of them. You've seen the pictures. Two of them to carry these grapes into to the Israelites. There's all this amazing abundance of blessing, but there were these giants in the land. These giants would make me look like a little bitty guy. You're talking about Goliath, 9 foot tall, just as big, a huge guy, huge giant, and the average Canaanite was around 7 to 8 feet tall. Now, Israelites, they were actually short for their height. Most Israelites are around 5'2", 5'3", maybe up to 5'6", 5'7".
Come on now.
Basically, go and stand up here.
Here's a 5'2" example.
King Saul was the tallest Israelite. He was at 6'1". He was shorter than me. That's how short the Israelites were compared to 9 foot, 8 foot giants in the land. You know, we're talking about today when they attacked Jericho. You understand that all of these people were hiding from the Israelites. They were all together within the walls. But these weren't little guys. They weren't dwarves. These were giants hiding from the Israelites. These were giants that were in fear of a group of smaller people, to put it in, to paraphrase, basically. So God says, no man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. He was saying, no giant shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. You understand that when you're courageous in God, that no giant can stand before you all the days of your life. That's your promise just as much as it is Joshua's. When we are in Jesus, that giant, no matter whether it be spiritual, physical, mental, that giant cannot stand in your path.
Amen.
They will cower, they will hide, because that's the enemy, because we have someone behind us, we have someone with us that is much stronger, that is much mightier, that is much greater. He says, as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not leave you nor forsake you. Go and get ready to turn off the lights here, son. I'll read two other scriptures. I'm going to show you a clip that many of you have seen, but it's a really fun clip to kind of emphasize this. Psalm 46, verse 1 through 3 says, God is our refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble. He's always there. Isaiah 41:10 says, do not fear, for I am with you. I will strengthen you and I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous hand. Let's go and watch this clip.
Thank you.
Awesome. Have you guys seen that movie?
No.
Bear? Yeah. It is a great movie for the family. It really is. But you know, if we had the words we put across that old ugly mountain lion, we could put fear, we could put disease, we could put pestilence, we could put all kinds of issues, all kinds of problems right across that bear, because that's what the devil is. He comes at us thinking that we're all alone. But you understand, just like what God was saying here, he was saying, Joshua, you're not alone. You may feel like you're alone at times, but I'm right there in the wings. You may not be able to see me, but I'm right there.
Amen.
And when fear is about to get you, when the devil thinks he has his way with you, you may scream and you may fight, but it's not from you that the devil runs, it's me. And God is there with Joshua, just like he's there with us. He's there to make us strong and courageous. We don't become strong and courageous through our own battles, through us. We become strong and courageous through the Lord. And that's something you get into your spirit. If you get into your mind, all those desires you have, all those things that you think, there's no way I'm going to achieve this, there's no way that I'm going to get past this, there's no way that this is going to happen, but God is right there. He's just like that big old daddy bear that is right behind that baby cub. And there, it wasn't the mama. The mama died. I can tell you the whole story, but we don't have to talk about the movie because then I wouldn't stop and start talking about movies. But everybody thinks it's Mama Bear. And you can think that. That's fine. But that represents the Holy Spirit. That represents what God does. Number two, and what Joshua excelled in. Everybody has their notes, right? He obeyed God's commandments. This is a big deal. God says, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that was written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Oh, you know what? I missed one. On A. 1A. You must understand that God wants you to prosper. He wants you to prosper. To be strong and courageous and to prosper. That's what that is. I don't know what blank that was, but let's go back now to obeying God's commands. Jesus speaks of obedience constantly. You know, Jesus in the New Testament, we always will talk about how Jesus did away with the law, which he didn't do away with the law, he fulfilled the law. Understand that. But Jesus would talk constantly about commandments. He would say, if you love me, follow my commandments. One of the biggest ways we show love to God is to follow his commandments. To be righteous. It's just like a child. When I tell my son back there, and I say, John, please take the trash out. Son, by the way, don't forget Tuesday, take the trash out. Son, I want you to take the trash out. Oh, no, Dad, I'll do it. And then, on Wednesday morning, at 5:30 in the morning, Dad's out there grabbing two trash cans and pulling them out, because my son forgot to take the trash out. John is a great kid. I'm just using you as an example, son. He always takes the trash out. So, let you know. But how is he showing love to his dad? By following my commandments. How do my kids show love? By following our commandments. You know, it's a fascinating thing. We think that we can just treat God differently than we treat our own parents. And we think, well, he's going to understand. God created this whole thing, guys. He created how we operate, how we work. And the kinship between parents and their kids is very much like how God treats us. Those commandments are important. Obey his commandments. He's telling Joshua, you want to be protected? You want to be under my charge? You want to be like that big old daddy bear that's protecting the baby cub. You want God to be there, you must follow his commandments. That baby cub probably, I don't remember the movie that much, but he probably got away from the big daddy bear. He probably got away from it because he wasn't listening, kind of wandered off. He wasn't under the authority of that big daddy, and then the mountain lion started coming after him. That's how the devil is. He'll come after you when the Lord's not there. A, you must understand that God's commandments do protect you. They're not there to just cause you trouble. Your mom and dad, Jaina, love you, right? Right? But you need to follow their commandments. And what does the Bible say about following your parents? You're gonna live a what?
Long life.
That's a big deal. Number three, he understood his call was greater than himself. To this people you shall divide as an inheritance the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. Guys, we live in a temporary world. And it's very easy to think about ourselves. It's very easy to think about money and trying to provide for our family because that's what we're supposed to do. But what if we looked and we said, okay, God, direct me to make a difference. Not just to make a difference, but a difference for the future generations. The unfortunate thing is we have an America that was created by men and women just like that. Can you imagine what our nation would be like if they were as self-centered as we are now? There would be no nation. I'm telling you, it wouldn't even look like a nation. It looked like I can't imagine what it would be like. Can you imagine if George Washington was as into himself as our leaders nowadays? Can you imagine what Abraham Lincoln, if he would have been so into himself that he just wanted to do away with the war because he just didn't want to go, he just didn't want to mess with it? Can you imagine what our nation would be like? Can you imagine what our nation would be like if those men and women, those fathers of our nation, if they would have had the same attitudes that our young adults have nowadays? My goodness, how amazing it is. We have to understand that call is greater than ourselves. Everything we do, everything we work for is temporary. You may think that you're creating some kind of special following. You're doing something that is almost, that's amazing, but if you're doing it for yourself, it's not going to last. Think about this. I'm amazed at my kids when I mentioned really popular actors and actresses. When I was younger. Not when I was a kid, when I was younger. I'll mention, in fact, I could probably ask them right now. We have some younger kids in here. Kids, if you know who these, now you might know because I mentioned them, but tell me if any of you know who Tom Selleck is. Okay, you know why? The boys in the back, they know. You know why? Because they just watched Quigley Down Under. They know Tom Selleck. But if you ask most kids who Tom Selleck is, most of them will not know. You ask them, who's Brooke Shields? Guys, who's Brooke Shields? Must have been some woman, I don't know. Brooke Shields, who knows who Brooke Shields is? Come on. Everyone here except the young ones who know who Brooke Shields is.
Just perform one.
How about Farrah Fawcett?
Oh, yeah.
Ooh, Tyler, Farrah Fawcett. You know who Farrah Fawcett is? He has no clue who Farrah Fawcett is, doesn't he? Farrah Fawcett was the, I mean, that makes every guy in this whole place blush when they hear the word Farrah Fawcett. That's how, yeah. Who is Kareem Abdul-Jabbar? Come on. If you're a basketball guy, you know who he is. If you're not, then you don't. But yeah, who? Kareem Abdul-Jabbar.
Oh, I know who
yeah,
he
Kareem.
Is.
But you have someone now that has nothing to do with basketball, they have no clue. Or maybe even Larry Bird. Someone as popular as Larry Bird. Well, the guys know basketball, know Larry Bird, but back in the day, everybody knew who Larry Bird was. Even if you didn't know what that round orange ball was, you knew who Larry Bird was. He was that popular. Well, you say this, but you think, oh, those are just actors. Here's what happened to me, which was really interesting. In 1997, yes, I'm dating myself, but in 1997, I had a kids camp in Ozark with about over 100 kids, and I had started this kids camp young and much more capable of handling a bunch of kids. And I was bringing in a group of about 20, 30 kids. We were talking. I said, well, you know what we need to do? We need to get together. We had a little movie theater I set up over at the place. And so we had like three different areas. We had an outside area where where a third of the kids would go. We had another area where they would play video games inside when it was so hot in August and everything. Then we had like a movie theater that I had created, like a room about like this size that had a big screen. It was really cool. And I told the kids, I said, so what movie would you guys like to see? You know, they've worked towards it for that week when we watch a special movie. They're naming up all these popular movies. I said, well, how about we watch Star Wars? Now, this is going to blow your mind, guys. Remember, this is 1997. Now, Star Wars had been on, but it's a cultural icon, whatever you call it, icon or whatever. Did you know none of those kids knew what Star Wars was? This was right before Star Wars Episode 1 came out. Okay? That's how fast that generation had forgotten about Star Wars. Now, that'll blow your mind. Star Wars. Now, of course, everyone knows what Star Wars is because Disney bought Star Wars and everything else. But those kids had no clue what Star Wars was. None of them, all 30 of them, didn't know. Because that generation at that point had not witnessed really Star Wars except on VHS. Or at that point, I think DVD was getting popular. So that's how fast things happen. That's how fast things become temporary. I was hit just recently, and that actually kind of helped me along to know what sermon I was going to be giving. But I had what I guess you would call it an epiphany, because I realized I've been several different places. I started a kids camp, and then I ended up going and I was a kids pastor at Nixon First Assembly for, believe it or not, 10 years. And then I moved from there to Maui, Hawaii, and was there for 6 years. And I realized, looking back, it's not that you don't get mad at things, it's just the way life is. But I realized that when I look back at Nixon First Assembly, there's nothing there anymore that would remind anybody of John Werner. And I was the kids pastor for 10 years. We made a major impact in that entire community, including the Assembly of God. And Teresa, you know what I'm talking about. Those that are involved in it, you know what we're talking about. We did things that had never happened in that church, as well as the whole, I mean, we were in the schools. Cody was in the schools. All this stuff was happening. We were hopping. We were really rocking it as a kids ministry. It was a great kids ministry. But now you go over there, nothing against anybody that's over there now. It's just that's what time does. Everything we did, the puppets, the you name it, it's gone. And the last icon of what John Werner did, or the impact I made at that church, just went down this last week. There was this playground outside that had been donated by my parents. It's a $30,000 playground. It was a great playground at that time. Well, of course, through the years, it got beat up and everything else. We realized as I was driving by, they had taken the playground down. And it hit me. That was literally the last thing that would remind anybody of John Werner in that church. Now, did it make me sad? Yes. Because that's 10 years of my life that I'm looking and going, God, what happened? There's nothing there to remind people of John Werner. And then I remembered something. I remembered Tyler Green. And I remembered all these kids. My own kids and Marla and some of these others, I remembered those kids. And they were impacted by that kids ministry.
Amen.
Guess what, guys? They're still around.
Yep.
These kids are still around. What we did, and those in this room, many of you in this room, what you did is you did something which I call a spiritual footprint. What you did is you placed your foot, a footprint there that many people may not know or even be able to look and say your name or say, well, this person made an impact, blah, 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 blah. Because your name and who you are is not what it's about. It's about the impact you make through
Amen.
Your anointing and through your call. Are you following me right now?
Yep.
Because that exactly is what we have to understand. You must understand that a lasting impact can only be made through others and the call of God. Working his kingdom, basically. The only thing that really matters is your spiritual footprint. Was the culture changed for God? Did you leave disciples for the work after you were gone? You know, there's a very popular story in our family, in the Morocco family. How many of you know who Lester Sumrall is? Okay.
Was.
Was Lester Sumrall. But a mighty man of God, very good friend of the family. Well, my the way he became a friend to my father-in-law and to the family, my father-in-law, his parents went and started to work in the Philippines in a small little ministry, small little church, and they grew this church into something amazing, and that church became the largest church in the Philippines, and then they handed it over to David Summerall, Lester Summerall's nephew. And I met David. He's a great guy, an amazing man of God. But David is now over that work, and it is still the largest church in the Philippines. God is doing amazing work. Multiple thousands of people have been saved, delivered, and healed through that ministry. That impact, that spiritual footprint that was placed by the Moroccos is being spread, and it's continuing throughout the years. But many people don't even know the name Morocco. Now, there are the older ones that know Morocco, you know, they started everything. They started that work. But multiple people in that church, and even that would have known them, have no clue who the Moroccos are. But yet, they know what that church is. They're impacted by that church. That's called a spiritual footprint. That is where God used them to make a supernatural impact for years to come. What you are doing now, what you're going to be doing in the future with this church as well as whatever ministry God has for you, what you're doing is you're making a spiritual impact. You're creating that spiritual footprint, because when you do what God has called you to do, when you look to Him and say, God, I want to follow after you, what happens then is that spiritual footprint is left there. It may not have your name, honestly, but it's not about you.
No.
In the future, no one's going to know who we are. Now, you can say, hey, oh, they're going to know me because I'm going to be famous. Some of you younger ones are. I just now gave you examples. How many in my daughter's generation care who Farrah Fawcett is? Not a soul.
Nobody.
No one has a clue who Brooke Shields is. That's exactly how it is in the kingdom. God is so amazing, because in His book, in His kingdom, your name will be there forever. Now, down here on earth, you're making a footprint, a spiritual footprint. How awesome is that? And that's what God is saying. That's what God is saying to them. He's saying, Joshua, you're here. You're going to bless the generations to come. Let me read that again. I'll go back to my notes. Where is it? I'm missing it here. Way prosperous. Oh, my goodness. I will get it here. I got a lot of notes here, guys. Anyway, I'll come back to it. Because I want to get to number four. Number four, he was patient. God says, do not be afraid nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Dismayed means to be unnerved or apprehensive, to be impatient. This guy was patient. He had to be patient to march around a city while everybody's taunting you, while everybody's throwing things at you and yelling at you. There's a lot of peas that were up there throwing things, you know, ice cream. Oh, wait, that's the wrong story. That's Josh in the big wall. I'm sorry, I get that confused. Jim's in Veggie Tales. Some of you are like, what? The Veggie Tales, Josh and Big Wall. You with me now? All right.
Yes.
They're throwing ice cream down at them anyway. It's fun. You guys want to see that instead?
Yeah.
Dismayed to be unnerved or apprehensive, impatient. We live in a society that hates to wait. This society hates to wait. Patience is not a virtue. When you say patience is a virtue, they'll throw things at you. They are going to throw ice cream and everything else at you, because patience is not a virtue in this society. It's about now, now, now. It's an instantaneous society. Our society has a problem saving for the future and working for the future, if you noticed. It's all about now. It's hard to save. That's too hard. So they'd rather have it now. They have that prodigal son mentality. And what happened to the prodigal son? The prodigal son lost everything, and he was in with the pigs. And that's where these kids are going, in with the pigs, if they don't watch it. They have a problem saving up for the future, which is tangible. So how can we expect people to save and work for heaven, which is intangible? If you have a hard time saving, if you have a hard time working for the present day and trying to save for the future just for your family, how much harder is it to work for the kingdom? So, where I'm getting with this, here's Joshua, who was very patient, who knew what he was doing through God. He had proven himself over and over and over. But understand something. If you have a problem physically with saving, with working, with just moving ahead in the physical, how can you look and say, well, I don't have a problem with working God's kingdom? I don't have a problem working with that, but I have a problem doing the other. But if you have a problem doing something that's physical, that you can see, how much harder is it to do something that you can't see?
Yeah.
And you've got a generation of people, I may not be talking to you, and most of you I am not talking to, but the generation, and I'm not ragging on you kids out here, but the generation of young adults, the generation of youth, they have a problem doing just the basic physical labor. Just working, understanding that they have to work in order to succeed. They have to work in order to get ahead. If they're having a problem with the tangible that you can see, how much harder is it going to be trying to work for the kingdom? Did I just nail any of you guys in the heart, in the head? My son's back there going, You must understand that God is molding you for a greater purpose than yourself. Joshua had been trained by Moses and raised up to be a mighty leader. It didn't just happen. Joshua was put in place for that specific time. Again, it's up to us to stand up and take that place, to step into the race, the baton handoff. We talked about stepping into the place like David stepped in the place where Jonathan and Saul should have been. That baton was being handed to Saul and he didn't want it. That baton was being handed to Jonathan and he didn't want it. And then God said, well, I'll take the baton and hand it to someone else, and he handed it to David. Are you going to let God hand that baton to you and run that race? If not us, it will be someone else, just like last week's sermon. If you have not heard the sermon from last week, please listen to it. It will impact you. You are meant for this exact time, for this exact moment, for this exact place. John Lacey, come and put that finger over here and shut that light off. I have another clip for you. Some of you will understand it. Some of you will give a look like, what in the world is this? But we're going to play it, and I'll explain it to you. Things that are found in that series by J.R.R. Tolkien. But what I love is translation for Gandalf, what he's saying is, he says, basically, God directs our steps, and that is an encouraging thought. You see, he was showing the difference between the two of them. You had Frodo, who wasn't willing to take this ring. This ring meant basically everything that was evil. It meant all the selfishness, all the pride. Just taking last week's sermon, it's fascinating that how it plays into all of this. Because there was a king, his name was Isildur. And King Isildur had killed, basically, the evil king, Sauron. And Sauron had this king, he had created this king. He was basically a devil. And now Isildur could take this ring, which represented all the evil, and he was told to take this ring and cast it into the fire that would destroy evil, that would destroy this ring, and he could not do it. He was meant to do it, and he gave in to the ring, and he was destroyed. And then you had this character called Sméagol that found the ring where Isildur had dropped it. He got a hold of it. He could have destroyed it as well, but it destroyed him instead. You see, God has a plan for people. He has a plan to use them for the greater good and for what they're supposed to be doing. But it's still their choice as to whether they want to do it or they want to give in to evil. These characters gave in to evil. You had Gollum, Sméagol, who actually changed him physically, and he became this creature named Gollum. He was a normal, like a hobbit, like a character, and he became this evil person. This almost looked like a demon. And then, of course, he lost the ring to Frodo's uncle, who was Bilbo, and Bilbo found the ring, and then Frodo ended up getting the ring. So, are you following me so far?
Oh, yeah.
I lost you, right?
Right there with you.
But Frodo has the ring. He is the second string character. Here's all these guys that could have done and could have destroyed this evil and saved so many lives, but now he's the second stringer that is coming in here, that it now falls on him. And that's why when he looks at Gandalf, he says, I don't want this. I don't want this burden. And Gandalf looks at him and says, well, this is your time and this is your place. God gives us that time and that place. We can decide to run the race, to take that baton, to go and do what God has called us, or we can sit back and say, nope, I don't want it. Then it goes to the next person. It's our choice to run the race. Think of all those born for a specific time and place in the past. Think of them. Think what would have happened if it hadn't been for these men. I'm going to name just a few of them. Moses. Joseph. John the Baptist. The Apostle Paul, Martin Luther, Christopher Columbus, John Calvin, George Washington, Billy Graham, yes, James Morocco. Is your name going to be added in that list? Is God going to add that list to you in heaven and say, you are my servant. You did what I told you to. Good job, good and faithful servant. Is he going to say that to you just like he said to these men and to these women? God can continue to point to every one of you. You're meant for absolute greatness. Not to make a difference for yourself, for temporary fame, but for an everlasting kingdom, for an everlasting work, for an everlasting Lord.
Amen.
This work, who knows where this is going to go? We know what the Holy Spirit has led us to do. We know the Holy Spirit is leading. We know that there's a purpose deriving what we are to do. But here's the big one, and it's a big but. The problem is, I'm cracking myself up here. I am totally cracking myself here. Ken, go ahead and toot your horn. I don't know. I'm just. Here's the big deal, guys. Where am I? We are called for a specific purpose. And it's our choice as a group to be mandated and to do what God has called us to do. And we can say yes, and we can run that race, or we can just basically say, COVID has got us. I don't want this anymore. There it goes. Ben, I'm so glad you're in this group. This is awesome.
Ask me, you shall receive.
Let's read some scripture. We need to read scripture. We're going to close this thing. Philippians chapter 3, verse 12 through 14. Not that I've already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. This is Paul speaking. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Such an amazing, amazing scripture. One more I want to share with you. Hebrews 12, 1 through 2. Therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Please stand with me. Isn't it awesome to have a call that God has given you? And if you are standing there and saying, no, well, I don't feel like I even have a call. I don't feel like that I mean anything. I don't feel like I matter. Well, obviously, what's happened is God's not got a hold of you. And there should not be one person in this church that doesn't run after the call. This church is going to be a church of amazing calls.
Amen.
If I had anything, if God were to ask right now and said, John, I will give you anything you want for that church, what will it be? My answer would be that every person who walks through the door of the church from this day on will receive their call, grab the call, and run with it.
Yes.
And that we can help them. If anything defined this church and defined what my heart is, it would be that.
Yep.
That every person does exactly what God has for them and that they make that spiritual footprint. I don't care if your names are written up on some sign. I don't want my face plastered across the sign because I want people to go to this church. Right? I don't care about my face on some screen, my face on some billboard. I don't care about your faces being on there. I get more excited for your face to be on there, to be honest with you. But the thing is, it's not about your face. It's not about your name. It's about your spiritual footprint.
Amen.
And if you make that footprint in this community, in this state, in this world, what amazing things can happen, and how many people, Dan, can get saved?
Mm-hmm.
How many people, Dan, can we get out there? I'm pointing to him because he has a heart to get out and to just get a hold of some people and bring them in. We were talking about that. God has called each of us to reach out beyond these four walls to do amazing things. I want everybody to bow your head. I'm going to ask you to raise your hands right now, and I want you to pretend. Yes, pretend. I'm a kids pastor, so we can pretend a lot. I want you to pretend. Actually, take your right hand. Raise your hand right in the air like this. And I want you to pretend. Make a fist right here. And I want you to pretend that you're grabbing a hold of the baton. Go ahead and close your eyes. And I want you to imagine that God has a baton down there, up in heaven, and he's reaching down with that baton, and he's saying, now, do you want this or not? And I want you right now to reach up and claim that baton and say, Lord, I'm going to run the race. Everybody repeat after me, Lord, I'm going to run that race. Now I want you to imagine you grabbed a hold of that baton. That is your call. That is your place in God's kingdom. That's the special place he's given you and you alone. And you're going to run that race. Lord, I pray for every person here that they have that spiritual baton, that they're going to run the race, that they're not going to give up, that they're going to push through, that they're going to acknowledge you and do exactly what you called them to do, Lord, that they're going to get that strength from you, that encouragement from you, that they will stand in righteous faith. They will stand against the enemy, and they'll understand, Lord, that you're right there with them. I pray a special blessing over each and every one of us right now, that you help us run that race with every part of our being, Lord, that we'll make that spiritual footprint that you called us to make. We praise you for that. We give you the glory, Lord, that we'll not fall by the right, by the left, but we'll continue down that path you have for us to run that race, Lord. There may be times that we're even trying to run in quicksand, but you're right there with us. There may be times that it feels easy, that we can run 80 miles per hour, and there will be times that we can barely walk, we can barely put one foot in front of the other. But either way, Lord, we're running that race. We're enduring to the end. We praise you, Lord, that we're going to be able to bring people with us, that you're saved, healed, delivered, and that you're going to use each and every one of us. We claim it right now. And I rebuke the hand of the enemy off your people, off their minds, off their spirits. I rebuke that right now in Jesus' name. And I pray, Holy Spirit, that you work in the hearts of everyone here. Work in the hearts of their families, Lord. Get them involved, Lord. We praise you right now that you're going to put the people in their path to witness to minister to, Lord. That they will see many healed, saved, and delivered in their life, Lord. It won't be, they will not be spectators, Lord, but they're running that race and they're seeing it happen right in front of them, and you're using them. I praise you, Lord, every person here is going to see you use them in dramatic ways.
Yes.
I praise you, Lord. I give you the glory and honor right now. I thank you, Lord, that you're guiding, you're directing. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord, to know what to do. And I pray right now, Lord, if there's anybody here that does not know you, I pray that you work in their hearts. You work in their minds. You work in their spirits. Go ahead, everybody. Keep bowing your heads, and I want you to repeat this prayer after me. Dear Heavenly Father,
I believe
that you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for me. Dear Jesus, please forgive me
for
all my sins.
Be
my Lord.
Be
my Savior.
You
died for me.
You
rose again.
So
I can live an eternal life.
I
praise you for it. Now help me, Jesus,
to
run that race. Holy Spirit, be right with me. Let me never push you away, but always have you next to me. Always have you in me. Leading me.
Directing
me. And guiding me. I praise you for your blessing over your people. I thank you, Lord, that you bless them, encourage them, Lord, in all ways. That it's not about what you do for them, Lord, but what they are doing for you. For they love you so much, Lord. They're running that race. I pray for your blessing over all the families here. I pray a blessing and encouragement upon them, Lord. Blessing over this week. Blessing over their homes. Blessing over their families. Blessing over their workplace. Blessing over their minds, their bodies, their spirits, Lord. I praise you, Lord, they are blessed and they are anointed. I pray safety upon them this week. I thank you, Lord, this week will be an amazing week.
Yes.
It won't be a week of drudgery and complaining, Lord, but it'll be a week of praise. It'll be a week where we're going to see you glorified, Lord, in everything we do. I praise you for that, Lord. Now go with your sons and with your daughters this week. And I thank you, Lord, that this week, Lord, will be the absolute best week in your name. We praise you for that. Amen.
Amen.